listening to the stories of Tupac and Eminem, who were the first two artists that I was introduced to, really inspired me. The way they told those stories and the emotions that were being communicated, I felt those emotions. You know, different struggles, but I felt the same feeling.
I grew up in Southwest Sydney, where we listened to gangster rap. Gangster rap was relatable to us because people were getting shot and stabbed. People were selling drugs, you know, in our areas. We knew people like, oh, I'm not going to say surnames or whatever, lives around the block from us. Yeah, brother just came back from that rape charge that he copped 10 years for. So keep an eye out, you know, because we don't want to be bumping into those guys when we're walking around our own neighborhood. Like, stuff like that was reality. So when we listen to that music, that's what we'd relate to.
Initially, young people in America that felt disenfranchised and wanted to speak up and thought, hey, I don't see myself progressing in life. This stuff's happening to me. You know, I've been downtrodden or feeling oppressed. Write about it, rap about it. And then when people heard that around the world, they're like, hold on, they're talking about real issues. Maybe I could do that.
I mean, even if you refer back to, say, something as cliche as NWA, which was happening, obviously, in LA, and police brutality was a very, very serious issue that was being pretty much ignored by all forms of media and the public. And they were really at a point where they needed to rebel against what was going on. And obviously music throughout history has been a great form of rebellion. And I think that's where it all goes wrong. It wasn't being gangster for the sake of being gangster. They were products of their environment, yes, but it was very politically driven as well.
So if a society isn't healthy, or if there's a lot of negative stuff going on, it will reflect in a lot of our art. You know, it's not the genre where people go into a studio and go, today we're going to write a love song about, you know, like this fantasy relationship. Running from the police, that's right. Mama catch me, put a whoop into my backside. And even as a crack fiend, mama, you always was the black queen, mama. I finally understand for a woman it ain't easy trying to raise a man. I think at a time where a lot of our media is restricted and our expression is restricted, it's still so important to have, you know, these art forms or these music avenues.
From personal experience, when I was growing up, I saw or didn't see faces like mine or like other Asian friends of mine in the media, in TV shows, on ads, in film. And that absence of representation in the stories of mainstream Australian culture, to some degree makes you feel invisible.
And for me, I couldn't, I didn't understand why that was, you know, coming from like Fijian culture or island, and then hold on, I don't see any other cultures, you know, that I can relate to. And it can be quite negative for any young person that's trying to evolve and, you know, find their identity if they don't have something externally or in their environment to grab onto.
People with ethnic backgrounds gravitated towards hip hop because they saw people of different colors, different cultures getting into it. Hop in your helmet, the punish is ready. Meet me and Beatles with noodles, with noodles, do while he's slurping spaghetti. Everybody kiss the floor, don't be crack. More if they move, noodle that. Dead in the middle of little, little, little. Did we know that every riddle to middleman who didn't do diddly?
I remember living out on the mission in Yundamu, and I used to get teased for being pink. And then I remember moving into the city, into Adelaide, and I used to get teased for being coloured. So growing up, I always felt a bit lost. Like, who am I? I wasn't one of those black fellas who was way into lore and culture. But then again, I didn't feel like I was the mainstream part of society either. when I found hip hop, it was just like, ah, there's my niche, you know, and I didn't even know about the hip hop culture until I started going to workshops, and it was a workshop run by Morganics, and he broke down the elements of hip hop and how it came about from oppression and all that kind of stuff, and it just blew my mind. And that's when I kind of went, wow, okay, no wonder I connect so well with it.
When I talk to people about Pacific, Fijian culture and hip hop, I always say, you know, back in the day, ancestors did that, you know, the oratory traditions, and today I do that, but through hip hop. I always talk about the links between the Masi or the Tapa motifs and graffiti up on the wall. I talk about the DJ and the drummer, you know, being the heart of the music, and then also, you know, the like the Hakka dancer or the Meke or the Hula dancer being similar to the b-boy or the b-girl. To me, it's just like a modern expression of, you know, our indigenous cultures wherever we're from.
When you think about hip-hop and the strong legacy and history of you know, speaking on society's ills and society's woes, and the need for knowledge of self, and the need to be always asking questions. I mean, that's at the core of hip hop. That's also at the core of my cultural and historical legacy that was handed down to me as well. If someone has a problem and there's an issue in society in relation to inequality and injustice, Sikhs should be putting their hand up to say, no, this is wrong and we need to stand up for it.
Was brought up in a household, two households, which respected the diversity. We were very much introduced to, my sister and I were introduced to Chinese culture and Australian culture. And I lived for a year when I was 5 years old in Singapore. My mum speaks fluent Mandarin. My dad speaks fluent Cantonese. For me, that mix of cultural heritage is very normal. I was born in Malaysia, but brought up in Australia. I feel like I have a foot in two worlds, and I relate to mainstream Western culture, but I also feel quite natural in mainstream Asian culture. My self-identity and my musical identity have been about trying to confound and confront the sort of stereotypes that I've been labelled with.
Being Tongan in this music had, especially when I began music in the late, early 90s, there wasn't many islanders doing hip-hop, and it really felt like that automatically made me different to a lot of MCs. A lot of MCs lived in the west suburbs of Sydney, west suburbs of Melbourne. I lived in Canberra and I was Tongan, and it was automatically differentiated my whole style, and just growing up with different music as well, church music, hymns, and I feel that influenced the way I delivered rhymes. They say, if you stand for nothing, you fall for anything, developing an awful legacy. If you got no cause to live for, then I would understand why you couldn't give more of the stuff. I can't stay stuck. Since a kid, my mind was made up. Read between the lines in the paper. I guess there's all kinds in Australia. My boy said these guys need a shake up, and you were gonna say what? Nothing. Yeah, I thought as much. How we let racists walk with us. Everyone ridiculed Pauline Hanson, but then I see her on the TV dancing. That's what I'm talking about. Feel my tantrum, right hand on the heart, stand for the anthem. So why is the speaker for if we cannot speak up more? Just remember, while your limbs are moving to the music, you got a head too. Use it.
In the earlier days, they'd think that all hip-hop heads were homies. You know, so in Sydney, there were like the surfies, the punks and the homies, and we all got kind of put into that category.
People assume that you're going to have baggy pants and a baseball cap and you're going to be rapping about dot, 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 you know, insert worrying topics for parents. You know, it's it's got just as many cliches and stereotypes as rock and roll, as any other form of music.
There were moments where people were like, you can't rap, it's an American culture. And to me it was like, well, does that mean you can't do country music? You can't sing opera because you're not Italian? There was a lot of that sort of ignorant attitude towards people trying to make hip-hop. I mean, granted, at the start of hip-hop finding its feet in Australia, we were trying to emulate American artists. But as it grew and progressed, we developed our own style. And
once I really started to commit and made hip-hop and started playing shows, I also saw that hip-hop itself had its own closed ideas of what it should be, and that there was a certain fashion and a style and a way of presenting yourself which I found, occasionally intimidating, laughably masculine, and quite narrow-minded.
I get these anonymous questions like, you're not like the other Australian rappers, and I'm like, what do you mean? Like, I'm exactly like the other Australian rappers. And they say, oh, you like art and you like all these other different things, you're not just into hip-hop. And I'm like, so do all the other Australian hip-hop artists. Like,
within the genre, the sense of belonging also became a tribal form of excluding other people, and I didn't ever relate to that.
In 2009, I got offered the position to go on tour with Nas when he had his first headline tour. We did promo shots. They said they've seen the photos, and they said that you're not allowed to go on tour with your turban. Is that going to be an issue for you? And I said, yeah, I'm not going on tour. You know, I'm not going to, if they don't accept me for who I am in totality, then we're not doing it. You know, there'll be other opportunities. And in the back of my mind, I'm like, well, I know what Nas stands for. I know what the other artists stand for. It's in contradiction for whoever's putting on this tour, or whoever's the one who's requested this, to make that request in the first place. And so I said, look, I don't want to be a part of it then. We still ended up doing the tour, and they were like, okay, look, whatever, you know, you do your thing. And so I was able to present how I wanted to present.
Forever rising is my manifesto, a manifesto with rhymes too much to let go. Ain't afraid to destroy, they give them what they deserve. My perspective, I observe, swiping the curve.
At no point should an artist feel like they should have to compromise who they are, what they stand for, their valuables and their principles. If they truly believe in it, there's other ways for it, you know, for an artist to do their thing and still get to the end point or the goals that they want to get to.
Even before they hear the music, if they pick up the album cover, they're gonna go on what they see straight away, you know.
Like, hip hop can be a fickle kind of scene, in that you got to sort of project a certain staunch bravado or whatever, which is, you know, it's what it's all about too. And if the release or the artist, if that's their image, then that's what it should be, and they shouldn't compromise it. But at the same time, like, if that's not who you are, and you're, you know, trying to project different emotions and feelings in your music, then the visuals should reflect that too.
Often MCs and artists or dancers, or they will take characteristics of themselves and amplify it in order to project the message that they want as artists. And so as characters, they their image is reflective of the characteristics that they want to highlight in order to make a point. You know, you think of the juxtaposition of Chuck D and Flavor Flav, and the image of Chuck D, and when the whole Public Enemy crew is on stage and the soldiers, and you know, that's characterized and brought out and amplified because of the message that they want to reflect, that comes from, you know, a burning fire within themselves. It's not in response to, and it's not there to appease other people and say, you look, well, I'm going to present myself so it looks pleasing to you, and therefore you're more likely to engage with my stuff. You know, that I think that's where you know, the idea of image can be distorted.
You know, it doesn't matter if it's a corporate client or a hip-hop artist, you're trying to create a brand, so a recognizable identity. And you know, the best way to achieve that obviously is to come up with something that's striking and memorable, and that represents what the artist is about, or the company's about, or the client's about. But then the consistency of the use of that brand is very key.
So if you can create
really great collateral with photos that are really well art directed and have interesting things going on. And then that tie into the album art so that you see it and it all links together. And the logo somehow reminds you of that. No matter what element of that someone sees, they'll think of the sound that you create.
Great examples of that in hip hop are the Wu-Tang Clan, you know, that W, or Public Enemy, with their logo, which has been the same since their first album. That's what we try and suggest to the artists that we work with, and that's sort of worked out well for guys like Bliss and Esso. You know, like, we did their logo for their second album and they've used it consistently ever since.
When things are working really good in the little system that you have set up, it's a joint venture between the artist, the manager, and the label. Obviously, the artist should always have final say. It's their product, but that isn't always the case. You'll have situations where the manager has way more power than they should, and they'll make the final decision. They'll go, no, I don't like it. Or that might happen with the label as well. The label might try and take control of what the, you know, thing, and the artist could be sitting there like, I fucking hate this. You know, this is not what I want for my album. Sorry, sign the contract.
I think on a global scale, you can see that you don't necessarily need a label anymore. I was actually signed on the cusp of that. The best thing about being independent, no matter where you are in the world, is that you've got more control of what you're doing, and you've got more control of your artistic integrity. You've got more control of what you want conveyed to an audience.
Commercial success is a good thing. Don't, you know, we shouldn't knock that. You know, that's what we're all aiming for, is to be able to make this into a career so that we don't have to go work a 9-to-5 and, you know, we can survive making music. And that's really hard in this country, especially with hip hop. So, you know, watching some groups get to that level is a great thing. I think the negative side comes in is when people are making music specifically to try and be able to get to that. So they're kind of almost like dumbing down their music. They're making it more accessible. They're making it softer. they're making it more radio friendly. Or actually, in this country, they're making it Triple J friendly.
I think people that write underground music see accessibility in a jaded light. Not everyone, but definitely some. That being accessible is somehow wrong. And I think that being accessible in the right way is being able to communicate effectively with as many people as you possibly can.
People think there's a formula. There's no formula. If you want to be successful, there's hard work and there's a lot of artist development. If your sound develops into something that may be a little bit more commercially viable, fantastic. But people couldn't tell me that Gotye, who just won the album of the year overseas, could tell me that that was a commercial formula and he's the biggest selling artist in the world. One massive thing that I get really frustrated, I call it the Black Eyed Peas syndrome. You know, everyone's like, Black Eyed Peas did it, you know, like they sold out. They became this, they became that. You can imagine if you're a hip hop artist or you're an artist just writing constantly, constantly, constantly. If you take it seriously, you're not going to get stuck in that sound. You're going to want to push your own boundary, add a dimension to it, you know what I mean? And next thing you know, Will.i.am is on the next commercial sound. Could he have predicted that when he started? Was he just like, oh no, nah, like I'm going to do it one way and then I'm going to switch it up completely and just make it commercial and just blah. No, you develop into that. You know what I mean? So what I would say is that you can essentially make whatever the hell you want successful or commercial or pop because that is popular. You know, underground music can still be popular.
I remember I was actually listening to an interview I did with Africa Bambaataa just the other day. I put it up again. I was listening to it, and even he was saying, you know, like, you know, the corporate people, they're throwing money at this. You just, that's not a bad thing, you know? Just know how to use it. Don't, you know, there's a lot of greed in this world, and it carries over to, you know, hip-hop, you know, and put money back the right way, and, you know, we can take a little bit more control, and instead of letting them control us, we should be dictating the terms, and, you know, like, this is our culture, this is, they don't know shit about this. All they know is, like, hey, this is hot right now. Oh, okay. Yeah, we need to get more of this. Yeah, here's a couple of $1,000s.
I have never discriminated against the accent at all. I've copped a lot of shit. I've heard a lot of American-sounding guys give Australian-sounding guys shit. The way I look at it is, like, you don't tell Van Gogh that he's a shit painter because he doesn't paint the way you paint. You know, just because someone does abstract art and realistic art, it's not that, you know, you don't compare them and go, like, that's supposed to be like that. It's art is interpretation, you know what I mean? Music isn't art, so you do it the way you interpret it.
There are differences between local hip-hop and hip-hop made elsewhere. I mean, the accent is first and foremost, I feel, and that's why we always fought for us to rap in a neutral accent, you know, in our natural accent, because it automatically differentiated us to, you know, from French, from Japanese.
When I first heard it was a bit awkward, like, because I just had never heard it, and I was like, whoa, this is bizarre, but it's sort of weird, and I don't know how to take it. My ears had to adapt to it, but then after I heard it enough, I sort of began to appreciate it, you know, and then listen to it as well, and then I just listen to everything. The tough thing was, though, like, you know, people would always make it an argument and be like, oh, it's this versus that.
So I think there has to be a little bit of leniency when new rappers come out and they may say a word differently here and there.
It's true, when Hilltop Hoods blew up, that a lot of local artists thought, okay, that's the sound that we need to sound like, that will blow up. But that's not the case, you know, because a lot of people do try and emulate that sound, but don't get that same success or even attention.
Some people have really interesting accents, and they are being themselves, and that might not necessarily mean that, you know, they're a total Australian dialect, and their cadence is like, you know, a bloke, Aussie bloke or whatever. Then that'll come across, and that's really cool.
I took it to the States when I was in LA. I had like hip hop CDs from here, and, you know, like, literally people would cringe. It was bizarre. Like, but I'd already become so adapted to listening to it. And then I'd go like, yeah, so this is what they do in Australia. And they'd be like, oh dude, just shut it off. Like, they couldn't hear it.
I mean, when we began making music in 93, 94, we had to say Aussie hip hop, because at that point there was no identity for us. So we had to say, look, this is hip hop made here. We're calling it Aussie hip hop. But 93, what's that, 20 years on, we don't have to say that anymore, because it's just hip-hop now. Australian hip-hop, I don't mind, but Aussie hip-hop nowadays just has a stigma attached to it that has, like I said before, like a redneck sort of element.
Not all Australians, but a lot of Australians are very patriotic about being Australian. So if you say it's Australian Vegemite, as opposed to Vegemite, they're more willing to buy the Australian Vegemite. And so if you say it's Australian hip hop, the kind of evokes that conditioned patriotism that we kind of have, or at least like white bread kids kind of have, which is the majority, of being invested in it or somehow feeling like they should support it.
It started off in the right place, you know, because we felt like we're proud of our local artists, but yeah, now it's just like, just support it if you like it, you know. Don't like it just because it's Australian, just like it because you just like good hip-hop music and you dig the artist.
Now, there's a lot of you know, people out there now who I think have grown up on Oz hip hop and they don't even know about American hip hop, and that's not the way to go. You know, you've got to be open to everything because it's being made all around the world. So, and then clinging to that as this is all I'm going to listen to. It's like, no, like, I only listen to Oz hip hop. It's like, come on, man, like, what are you doing?
Like, anything that's made here, they'll listen to. But then they'll just talk shit about stuff that's coming from America, stuff that's coming from Europe, from UK. And for me, I think that's an ignorant way of listening to the music.
Although it was a thing to get it started, support Australian hip hop, I think it kind of developed like a beast of patriotism and became a vessel that harbored, you know, Aussie pride and stuff.
Understand what both sides are saying, you know, because you do see it, you know, you do see these little young kids, you know, Aussie hip hop is white, you know, like, and but the argument that some people were making was that Australian hip hop is racist.
I kind of get frustrated because it's so much more complex than just going, there's racism in Aussie hip hop, but it's fucked up at the same time because how are we going to word it? Black fellas were talking about it and everyone was brushing it off and going, nah, there's no issue. It took a white fella to stand up and say that. Yeah. And then people were like, oh, maybe there is a problem here.
Australia has a massive history of race relations way back to the beginning of European settlement. And so we have never addressed that as a nation, honestly.
There is inherent ideas that everyone has about race within hip hop. I mean, even in America, I think white rappers have a tougher time, and I think in Australia, non-white rappers have a tougher time. It's a weird flip, but it's there.
I just think it's the most ridiculous thing on earth that anyone would think that hip hop is anything but an expression for everybody. I kind of almost think it's a joke, and just not interested in some of those debates because it just feels so silly to me.
I got in a lot of heat from it, from the, you know, one of the two main girls that were constantly fighting people about it, you know. You guys are all racist, you know, there's no chance a black person. And I was like, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, look at Death Wish Cast, you know, as a prime example. One of the most respected groups has been around for 20 years. First of all, you look at them, you see white. White Australia. No, we got a Filipino in the group. You know, one of the guys is from South America. You know, one of the guys has Aboriginal family members. What about my homegirl Queen G? You know, and Desiree, the Killer Queens. They hustled. Their product was good. They made the right moves. They were playing festivals all over Australia. We used to freestyle back in her school.
So it's kind of like, well, what does this label Australian mean? And who's defining it? You know, I know now that I couldn't give a shit what people say is and isn't Australian. I know in my heart that I was born here and that my experiences have been shaped by my life here and my values and stuff have been developed here. My passport says I'm Australian, you know, so it's like, well, I couldn't give a shit about what anyone else says. But there's still that conflict because you know, there's almost like this entitlement to the word Australian.
My experience of race identity in Australian hip hop is also peppered with lots of jokes, lots of humor, lots of overt discussions about these things. I am hard Caucasian, still very Asian, a mad variation of what you call Australian. When I'm on the pavement, treated like an alien, cop a little racism, this is what I say. Consider me the face of the Asian horde, the yellow caramelists, bred from the north. My people immigrated over here on boats. We can't just look at jokes and your women folk. Jokes!
I think that the problem is coming from, you know, more country towns in Australia, Triple J listeners, people that don't even really listen to hip hop, that are fans of some of the bigger artists, that's where that's coming from. The 360 fans, the Bliss and Esso fans, the Hilltop, those people listen to those groups and that's it. If you are into hip hop, it's impossible to be racist because this whole culture started from black and Puerto Rican dudes in New York, you know, like, it doesn't make sense, you know, like to kind of segregate it to a white Australian thing. That's some Australian culture shit going on, not Australian hip hop culture shit.
Now in hip hop, artists are saying, you know what, enough's enough. There's such a vibrant, diverse collection of artists coming from all across the country, from different backgrounds, who say, you know what, I couldn't care less about your sense of entitlement to this label. You know, we're at that point now. I feel like we're banging on the door where artists like Jimblah can go on Rap Attack and be so open that, you know, people then start to think about.
See, Captain Cook went and sailed ashore and brought a whole boatload of convicts. Are you intrigued yet? See, in Britain, their prison system was overwhelmed because support was big business. What I mean by that, there was the filthy rich, but no middle class. What's left? Poor, oppressed victims. You steal a loaf of bread, but that's a 5-year sentence. Now that's a lot of prisoners. Where's the royal fam gonna put them? They set sail in search of a land abroad. And that's the real reason why they came here for. A nation founded on oppression. No wonder they still oppress us. Because those same hypocrites stole a whole fucking continent. Ironic? Yeah.
That's not knocking on the door. That's saying, you know what? Take a listen to what I'm saying and hear it loud and clear.
Whether what the stuff I'm talking about is going to be detrimental to my career as a hip-hop artist, who cares, man?
I've done a lot of workshops and spoken to young Koori guys who have said they won't go to Aussie hip-hop shows because they think they're, you know, a predominantly racist audience, because I think at some point the audience somehow became associated with the sort of that an element of young white Australia, which I think we associate with the Cronulla riots and with Southern Cross tattoos and the flag, and the Aussiness of Aussie hip hop became again an exclusive thing, a way to say this is ours and it's different from American hip hop because it's white. And I've had a lot of conversations about this, and I would never put that on the artists, because every artist I've ever come into contact with, be they breakdancers or rappers or producers, are open-minded, lovely individuals who love the music and the culture and respect where it's come from, and at the same time how they're going to adapt it to themselves and their life.
That's the other thing, because at the end of the day, every single artist was a fan to begin with. So if we let this thing get out of hand, there's going to be these fans who are turning into artists. That's what I think we've got to be careful about it and try and just stomp it out right now.
Everyone is aware of it, but like I said, it's unfortunately not everyone is being vocal about it, and it sucks.
You know, you can't force someone to go and do something if their heart's not in it, you know? But at the same time, when you look at what hip-hop's about and where it came from, we have, like, an obligation to do this, you know? Like, how dare could we just stand by and let this thing happen? The forefathers would be sitting there they're shaking their heads, man, you know? And if there's any medium where we can stomp out this shit and talk about it in a fucking open manner, this is the one, you know?
In the same way that racism is taught, it's not something inherent, you know, it's generation upon generation teaching young people, you know, certain ideas and thoughts. Same thing with homophobia. And so the fact that hip-hop artists would use homophobic lyrics was a reflection of that lack of awareness around the humanity.
What escaped me was how they couldn't draw the line, the connection between the oppression that I think gay and lesbian individuals feel in society and the same oppression that racial minorities and the, you know, oppressed peoples feel, and that it's the same struggle, and it's, you're trying to conquer negative stereotypes and a society that's not open to something, and you are from a group of people who have no choice, or just it's who they are.
The idea was always to have the Australian context and Australia's political climate addressed in a song.
Our own Prime Minister can't even explain. We ask her the question, she just turns away. They're too afraid to lose their voters come election day. Lost sight of the goal to rid the world of hate. But Julia, remember back in the day when women couldn't vote because they were born that way. They were out trying to fight for rights and change. It's the same people that helped you, you just shun them away. I might not be the same, but that's not important. No freedom till we're equal, damn right, it's important.
I can't change.
So what was the thought process behind it? It was purely, you know, for me it was purely, okay, injustice exists, people are not afforded the same freedoms as others, that's not right. I have a duty as a hip-hop artist, as a Sikh, and as a human being, to address inequality whenever it presents itself.
Now, listen.
A lot of these kids who have this mentality, and it's a real ignorant mentality, they've just been brought up with it, you know? So much shit is instilled with them that if you take the time out to talk about it so they get a deeper understanding, they can walk away from that and go, ah, I see where you're coming from.
The world is a giant symphony of events and things, and, you know, change comes in the strangest places and the strangest ways. And I think in hip-hop is very direct. The emotional quality and the stories that are passed on through the lyrics and also through the music can be really confronting and can say things that you can't say in any other medium. You can't say it on the news. You could never say it on a talk show on the ABC about politics. It can be very straightforward and straight down the line. And that authenticity of the story, the voice of the person who's telling that story, when it's clear and it's crystal and it's true, it can change lives because people can hear that and relate to it and take that story and run and tell their own story and feel like they are being represented.
Have you ever been somewhere where it seems too hard to live your life, avoiding the strife? I have been, it's making me go insane. Everything seems to be held against me. They too, everyone is some sort of crazy game. Holding on to something just ain't the same. When I was 12, the first cigarette that I held, it
destroyed my life, I made my heart melt. And I'm doing what I can to show who I am. Do my thing, black, grab the mic and sing this thing. Cause growing up without a purpose hurts. Want a real reason to begin my search. Yeah, Mike is the name, so remember me. And I'm doing what I can to help you see clearly. Have you ever been around the life of everybody? And it is something that you always wanted to do. Have you ever tried to succeed in life for what you will need to gain the dreams that you please? Just lift your head high with me.
Generally, you'll find the top artists listen to American hip hop and have the understanding of what the culture is all about. The new generation, that's what we're trying to teach them.
I don't think a lot of us set out to be hip hop community workers. I know I didn't. It just kind of happened.
The minority of artists I know are the ones who don't do community work. It's really, you dig around, you find most artists who make hip hop have got some connection to doing community work or giving back in some way or running workshops or helping to spread knowledge.
I like to work on the ground level with people and change their perceptions of or perspectives on certain biases they may have one-on-one. And then I like to do that in my music to as many people as I can.
It works well with young people because, as I said before, they're trying to find out who they are, where, you know, what make their mark or create their place in society. So if they're into music, use their strengths, you know, and build on that. And not all of them will become, you know, famous musicians, and they may want that or they may not, but once they've, you know, achieved what their goals through music, you can show them, look, you can apply this to anything else in life.
I mean, even what we do out here, look how it's helping these kids, you know. We've got young kids, teenagers, you know, a little bit lost, don't really know what's going on in their lives, you know, coming from hardship or whatever. They're using it as a way to kind of express themselves. And that's the beauty of this culture. It's always been about that, you know, just kind of, life is shit and it's really hard and all this shit's going on and, you know, my mom's in my ear and this is it, all this stuff is happening. Let me just write a song.
He's younger than me, be sitting around smoking blunts. I got homies on both sides, don't come in trying to front. Life of ghetto kids, yo, but we're portrayed as dumb. Said the media's claiming that we all live by guns. And he show a story for a day and then dismiss it, cause they're focused on the gossip instead of who's really missing. Focused on the issues of today, claiming that they help the poor, your salvation stays the same. Yo, I don't understand why you take abusement from a man who raises his hand. This is God's land. Girl, the media can change you just from pictures in a damn pan. See the same little girl in a dress praying in church, just the same little girl in the booth putting in work. We all hurt. Don't ever contemplate your worth. I know life ain't the same, but it's time for us to make the change.
Out to those people because you see that you were there once, and someday that kid maybe will be passing on to the kid who's younger when he's an older guy. And you know, you're passing on knowledge and you're passing on a sense of trying to reach people.
Even though they might see what it is for what it really is, they just love it anyway. You know, it's like you coming into a place, into a school, and working with disengaged children who the education system isn't for them, and there's taken such a big discourse from it, and you come in with something like hip-hop, 50% of that work's already there. And so you're going in and you're masking the learning because you're teaching literacy. You're teaching reading and writing. You're teaching the importance of their story and their identity and their voice.
Hip-hop can't be notated like other genres can. Whereas a singer, you can score the music and you can show somebody and they can sing you that melody and hold the notes for the amount of time that the notes need to be held for. Now with hip hop, you can't hand somebody's lyrics and you can rap that verse exactly the same way that the person that wrote it intended. Same with turntablism and scratching. There's no notation for scratching at all, which is why hip hop therefore becomes a very personal form of expression.
The difference between teaching music and teaching hip hop is you get this whole value propositions. And so you're not just shaping an artist and a musician or a graph writer or a DJ or whatever. You're shaping a human being with values and principles that are at the core of hip hop and at the core of good, positive, community-minded human beings. We're in search for a leader to lead us, one that will never leave us, one with the people who never place some fences between us, one that will take us up to the sky in order to free us, one that will teach us and not take us to war. They will feed us. A leader won't keep you down. They find your strengths and then bring them out. Look for peace and get rid of doubt. They lead by action and not their mouths. They don't try and change you. They educate you. They sacrifice, and without supplies, they find a way to aid you. They know no excuses. They don't need no juice to boost us. They know wisdom like Confucius, and they won't mislead or confuse us. They find a new path and test it, perceive the truth and contest it, use their intellect as their weapon, and don't need the internet to be connected with the people. They plant seeds because they plan for a better day. They know the difference between lending a hand and taking your land away. That's the way that they are. They support you when there is nowhere to go. Just look in your heart, you can find a leader closer to home. Don't be mistaken. For young artists who are picking it up, it's always important to know the history of it, why it started, so that you can understand the inherent power within it. You know, it's not just, you know, making music to feel good. Sure, that's a positive thing to have. You know, that's a great thing to have. But you know, if all it's doing is making you feel good and not contributing to your self-development as an individual, you're missing out on the core of what hip-hop is, the real value in it.
If you want to be a hip-hop artist, just start, you know, and also just research, look at what other people have done in the past and then, you know, learn, whether it be beat making or writing, whatever you want to do.
Ask yourself, seriously, what do you want from hip-hop? You know what I mean? It's... hip-hop isn't just something that you contribute to. Hip-hop culture is something that contributes to you and your lifestyle and, you know, the way you carry yourself every day.
Question your very existence. Question why your culture informs you the way that it does. Question, you know, the society that you live in. Question everything.
Be persistent. Sometimes you gotta be stubborn. Sometimes you gotta be selfish, but you have to be persistent and dedicated. People will tell you you can't do it. Don't listen to them.
Work your butt off, and when you feel like you've worked enough and you're ready to rest and you're so tired, then work some more.
You have to practice, you have to perform, and you have to share your ideas and listen to feedback and not get upset or angry by it, but go, okay, I'll take that on board.
Do not follow the crowd. Do not bully or look down on anyone. Don't put anyone down to get higher. Just do your thing. Be you. Do you the best you can. Be authentic and try and bring something new to the game.
Industry rule number 4080. Record company people are shady. Keep your eyes and your ears open, because there's a lot of people who talk a lot of shit, and there's a lot of people who have kind of don't have your best interests at heart, you know?
Hip-hop's not the savior. It's not... I hate looking at it as in a sort of religious way, but I do know that it really can give people a strength. The music has strength in it. It has a quality of giving you the power, giving you some power back. And for people who feel like they have no power in society, that's really important. I think if you're an artist and you make the music, you realize that early on, you know. When you look at a room full of people who are celebrating and partying and vibrating on the same frequency because there's someone on stage just giving them good lyricism and good music, then you see it direct, firsthand. This is making the world better. So. Whenever I...
know life ain't the same.